When I began my YouTube Symphony series about 3.5 years ago, I was armed only with a primitive video-making program, a wholly inadequate internal microphone on my laptop, no video-making skills whatsoever, and a fairly close acquaintance with the music I began describing, along with a deep, long-standing love for it. I drew the final double bar on that project a couple of months back with the posting of my commentary over Dvorak's New World Symphony, and during the intervening time, I've been struck down by a serious case of pneumonia that has left me in a condition of forced idleness. Those who know me personally understand how strange a condition this is for me and how difficult it has been to adapt to it. I'm adapting still as I slowly recover my health, and during this downtime, I've gone back through my files and re-watched some of those early videos. Content-wise, they're not too bad, although producing them in unwanted haste as I did, I often glossed over details that I now find myself wishing I'd addressed and didn't take the time to arrive at the best ways of expressing what I did express. I've also been struck by just how embarrassingly ham-handed my presentations looked. Even though I'm still working with the same primitive video-making program on account of my flat learning curve when it comes to anything electronic, I have arguably gotten a lot better at it during the interim, and I've long since gotten myself a better microphone. So I think I'm going to commit myself to something like what I did earlier when I replaced my entire Beethoven Quartet series with new videos that look far better and describe the territory much more usefully than I did my first time through them, a trip also taken in undue haste. It's my intention to revisit Joseph Haydn's final 13 symphonies and give them better coverage, replacing the older videos as I complete the new ones. It may be that some of you who have been following my posts for the last year or less haven't even seen those earlier Haydn videos, and if that's the case, I hope you'll join me for this trip through them. And even if you have seen them, I hope you'll give me another chance to preach the gospel of Joseph Haydn. My original intent in this series was to address my efforts to those who, although they don't necessarily have an extensive background in what might broadly be called music theory, enjoy listening to music like this and think they might enjoy it more if they understood more about how it works. That's still largely my aim, even though my presentations have come to include a little more technical information and incorporate a bit more specialized terminology than they might have if my approach were purely descriptive. I suppose my target has broadened. It would please me very much, for instance, if undergraduate students enrolled in a form and analysis course were to find something useful in them. Understand that no matter where on that continuum of music education and experience you happen to lie, I want to give you something that will enrich your life. That's a kind of thumbnail sketch of my aims. I began my symphony series with Joseph Haydn's late symphonies because even though they were composed after the five Mozart symphonies that I took up next, it is Haydn who is most often identified as the founder of the great Austro-Germanic symphonic tradition, even popularly known as the father of the symphony. Haydn certainly didn't invent the genre. A generation of composers before him had made the start in that direction, but it was Haydn who, more than anyone else, defined the form, standardized it to a degree, and gave other composers an idea of what was possible within it. The morning, noon, and evening trilogy that he composed for the Esterhazy court in 1861 might be reckoned his first definitive efforts toward the shaping of the symphony, and the symphonies I'll be treating here, composed 3 decades later, are the splendid fruit of all that labor and research. I'd love to talk at length about Haydn's life and the many stages that his symphonic maturity went through, along with the circumstances that drove it, but that would result in a video of unforgivable length, so I'm just going to cut straight to the chase and begin with a little background about his 92nd symphony. This symphony, which bears the title Oxford, is the first of Haydn's symphonies to be associated with England, as were then the 12 remaining. The story is roughly this. Oxford University bestowed on Haydn the honorary doctoral degree in July 1791. This symphony, although it was already 2 years old, but was apparently unknown in England, was performed at a ceremonial concert in the Sheldonian Theater as an expression of the composer's gratitude, and has since been regarded as a kind of doctoral dissertation. That understanding, while not strictly accurate if one considers that the work was not written for the occasion, seems quite apt considering that the symphony abounds not only with Haydn's celebrated musical humor, but also with the kind of complex polyphonic writing largely regarded as learned style. If this work is understood as a doctoral thesis, it must surely be the case that a finer doctoral thesis in any discipline has rarely been produced. I do want to say something about that sense of musical humor that I just mentioned and talk about an unfortunate effect it's had on Haydn's reputation. Haydn tends to be brushed off by serious, high-minded musicians as somewhat glib and frivolous. In my view, this impression can only be sustained by the most superficial of listenings and could not possibly be further from the truth. I hope to demonstrate in these 13 videos that Joseph Haydn was one of the most profound composers who ever lived, and that his late symphonies are absolute masterpieces of the loftiest sort, even though every single one of them is apt to make you laugh aloud at some point or another. I cannot think of a single one that does not leave me glad to be alive and grateful to have had a life in music every time I hear it. In my exploration of this symphony and the first six of the London set, I'll be using the recordings made by George Szell and the Cleveland Orchestra during the late 60s. These are available on the Sony Classics label. There are many complete sets of Haydn symphonies available nowadays, but I've never heard another as polished and thoughtful and, for the most part, authentic sounding as these wonderful readings by George Szell and his Clevelanders. I will from time to time have a bone to pick with Maestro Szell, beginning with this one, but I hope you understand that the merits of these recordings, in my view, far outweigh the occasional lapse. All of Haydn's late symphonies take the familiar four-movement shape that he had defined over the previous three decades, which is this: a large-scale opening movement in sonata form, with all of these final 13 beginning with a slow introduction, with the single exception of number 95, followed by a slow movement that might be couched in a number of forms, with ABA and theme and variations most common, a minuet and trio, and a high-spirited final movement, usually in sonata form or in that hybrid form pioneered by Haydn, known as sonata rondo. Movements 1, 3, and 4 will reliably be in the symphony's tonic key, with movement 2 alone set in a contrasting key. The orchestra Haydn calls for here was standard for its time: a single flute, pairs of oboes, bassoons, horns, trumpets, and timpani, and a string choir including violins, violas, cellos, and basses. The violins are divided into two distinct sections, the firsts and seconds, and the cellos and basses are often treated as a single section playing bass lines in octaves. They are, however, occasionally treated as two independent sections. The strings do most of the heavy lifting, with the winds often playing coloristic and soloistic roles. This symphony's opening sonata form movement begins with one of Haydn's subtlest, gentlest, slow introductions, with the movement's main theme adumbrated in the introduction's sixth and seventh measures. The main body of the movement, which includes an exposition repeat, unfolds along standard lines that might be described this way: a primary theme in the movement's tonic key is followed by a group of themes in the dominant key, in the present case so closely related because of a shared four-bar incipit that the movement might almost be regarded as monothematic. The exposition I've just described is repeated, giving you a second chance to focus on the many thematic details and enjoy the harmonic journey from bright to brighter. This repeated exposition is followed by a much more complex development section, during which the two themes' motives are pitted against each other and worked out through a rich array of related keys, often minor in quality. Once that struggle has run its course, the themes return in more or less their original guise, but this time they are both brought back in the tonic key. This represents the reconciliation that is one of the central ideas of sonata form. The movement concludes with a coda that revisits thematic elements and rounds out the whole. That general description applies point by point to the music you're about to hear, and my running commentary aims to help you clarify it and keep your position located in the unfolding symphonic journey. To that end, I have capitalized the names of large formal units, even when such capitalization runs counter to the received conventions of English writing, and I hope you'll see it as more than a mere affectation. But of course, all I've done so far is outline its course as if mapping it, and although my running commentary will fill in a few of the map's details, the territory is always infinitely more interesting than the map that describes it. If you're not already deeply acquainted with this symphony, I believe you're going to be blown away by the interplays of motivic ideas, the range of color and dynamic contrast that Haydn evokes from the orchestra, the wealth of affect and invention, the sparkling humor, and all the other myriad details that betray one of the greatest minds in the history of Western music. Just follow everything you can and enjoy all the twists and turns and the perfect balance struck between the as expected and the surprising, all delivered at an unchanging tempo. Haydn didn't need to resort to the pushing and pulling of tempo that the later Romantics so often relied on to make their musical points.
Thank you.
The slow movement is a great treasure, set in the symphony's brighter dominant key, D major. H.C. Robbins Landon describes it as one of the most moving pieces in Haydn's entire output. It contains pages of indescribable beauty, tinged with an autumnal sadness and yet radiant with deep inward peace. This movement certainly invites the most sympathetic hearing you can give it. The movement includes a tormented middle section set in the parallel minor. This, of course, suggests the rounded two-part form known as ABA. The return of theme A includes one of the most personal utterances I've ever heard, and the coda is wonderful beyond any words I have to describe it. With the minuet movement, we return to the symphony's tonic key and its overall high-spiritedness. The trio is one of the most thoroughly syncopated things you'll ever hear, a real mind-bender. The fact that the trio is far more complex than the minuet, a complete reversal of the usual arrangement, suggests something bold and new, and certainly a symphonic voice to be reckoned with. This composer is unquestionably among the immortals.
Thank you.
Before we hear the final movement, I have a confession of sorts to make. I have vandalized this recording, and that cannot possibly escape your notice and perhaps make you cringe. But here's why I've done it. For reasons that I've given up trying to understand, Maestro Szell omitted this movement's exposition repeat. There's simply no good reason for doing that, and plenty of reasons not to. The exposition is short and absolutely must be heard twice if any formal balance is to be struck for this movement. It may be, as some musicians have argued, that the exposition repeat in 18th century music was sometimes little more than a convention, but that is certainly not the case here, nor ever in Haydn's mature music. My imposition of such a repeat, marred as it is by a momentary silence, does far less damage to this movement than Maestro Szell did it by omitting the repeat in the first place. I hope you'll listen past the unfortunately audible splice and hear the formal intent behind it. The movement is one of those quicksilver finales so celebrated in the music of Haydn. It seems no other composer of his generation, including the great Mozart, came anywhere close to Haydn's achievements in this dimension of his symphonic style. The movement is organized in sonata form with its several themes serving much the same functions as they did in movement one and following a similar tonal plan. The development is a contrapuntal whirlwind of incredible compositional virtuosity, and the coda is as witty as any you'll ever hear.
Thank you. Thank you.